Igor Shoifot's with me today from TMT Investments. Igor, good to meet you. Good to see you.
Lovely seeing you.
Just for those new to TMT Investments, give us a bit of an intro, a bit of a summary as to what you're about, if you would.
So we're a group of entrepreneurs, people who scaled their own companies to tens of millions, hundreds of millions of dollars. And about 7 years ago, we decided that we should help other people scale their companies. Started with raising 20 million, then raised a little bit more. Altogether, we raised over 30 million, invested in 43 companies, had 11 profitable exits. And just last year, as a highlight, grew our value by $20 million additional. So we're doing well.
So a good year.
Give
us an example of a couple of these companies that you're invested in.
Sure. I think for anybody in London, the one that would be the most familiar would be probably Taxify. That's an alternative to Uber that recently came to the UK and hopefully will do some great job squeezing Uber out of London, just offering basically cheaper rides and also sharing a little bit more money with the drivers. That's a company from Estonia that we were the very first venture capital investors in. Another great example would be a company called Reich, which is one of the largest by far project management softwares in the world, where we were followed up by the investors, billion-dollar investors such as Bain Capital, Scale. So very often we actually are trendsetters who invest in companies and then are being followed by really big guys.
That's interesting. What do you look for when looking at potential companies to invest in?
Well, usually that's probably the key question to why and how we will be successful and have been successful so far. We mostly look for very solid business models. We look for people who could demonstrate that they worked as a team and succeeded. And we're trying to make sure that we really understand the segment well. So in 7 years that we've been in business, we had about 12,000, believe it or not, meetings with companies. So legwork is what we do.
And how active in these companies do you become once you're invested?
It really varies. There are some companies in which we have board seats and we participate very heavily. There are some companies that we, you know, maybe talk once per 2 months about what's happening and just get reports. Sometimes we can really offer a lot other than just money, you know, connection to other investors, some thoughts on what business models work, where else they could look for traffic, where else they could try to acquire customers. Very often we could help them with personnel, make very valuable introductions. VCs usually are not just the people giving you money. They sometimes could help with a lot more.
And typically, how long do you tend to hold on to these investments for?
Well, realistically, we're not really very large investors. You could very easily estimate that from about $32 million that we raised, we made 43 investments, so we don't really invest that much per company. It's very rare that we play a very active role looking for exit, looking for other investors, but we do actually sometimes. Typically, that's when we have a 10%, 12%, 15% stake in the company. But typically, we have a rather small 1%, 2%, 3% stake. In that case, venture capitalists usually do not play a very active role. So sometimes the game is you make an early investment and then you actually help to bring bigger guys, and then the bigger guys, the likes of Bain, Scale, and others, they look for bankers who would help with exits.
But what kind of,
it doesn't depend on us.
What kind of returns do you look for?
Fantastic returns is what we look for. But realistically, the market is going really, really great. We're investing at a point when a company is already has customers, already has scaling revenues.
Right.
But on the other hand, we don't want to invest too late because by then the value of the company, the valuation is too high. So I wouldn't set a specific number that we'll look for, but I think realistically several, I don't know if I can legally promise something, but realistically probably several tens of percents would be something that a very successful VC fund would look for. And historically, you could look at our performance. It's not just that we're saying, we're promising stuff. We actually have shown some really nice numbers.
I suppose typically, given the space that you're involved in technology, I mean, you mentioned Taxify a moment ago, but a lot of these companies would be US-based?
Actually, if you look at our geography, I would say about half of our companies are in Silicon Valley, and that's where I'm based, in San Francisco. We have several companies in New York, several in Israel, several, as it happens, very interestingly, in Ukraine and several in Estonia. But typically their markets are not in Estonia. It's a 1.2 million people country, or in Ukraine, which is a larger country, but not a rich country. Typically they start there. They have really smart personnel that does development, design, project management, etc. And then they move their business and sales offices to San Francisco, New York, etc.
Well, those businesses in Ukraine, for example, how did you learn about those?
We, like I said, if you look at our feet, they're probably the most beaten parts of our bodies. We do a lot of legwork. So we go to a lot of conferences. We're fixture to so many panels. And Ukraine is a place where probably about half of our team travels to very often. The reason why we do that is because you can find really fantastic young companies. They're very, very promising. The trick, however, is you need to have a whole bunch of meetings with different companies. You can't, that's what sets apart a successful and experienced venture capital company from anybody else. You meet with a lot of companies, like I said, 12,000, believe it or not, in 7 years. You talk to them, you get to understand what it is that they're offering, what are their shortcomings, what are the advantages, where are the most opportune moments that you can come in, what you can help these companies with. And that's how you become successful, because you really bet on those who have not just a solid technology, but also a great ability to scale that technology.
Indeed. And technology itself is a broad space, but in terms of the sectors involved, any ones in particular that you see as the most promising?
Indeed, there are several. We traditionally have been investing in software as a service, in marketplaces, in e-commerce, specifically with the subscription model as its basis. We really believe in subscription. We think it's one of the most promising models because you acquire customers fast, you don't spend that much money on acquiring new customers. It's rather easy to predict where you're going to be going. It's rather easy to experiment with the existing subscription base. So all of the subscription-based companies in e-commerce actually have significant advantages over those that are just doing one-off sellings.
And you've mentioned potential opportunities too in the blockchain space.
Yes.
Any developments there?
Yes, actually there is a significant development. We've been very seriously looking in this for quite some time. We're right now in talks with some blockchain gurus about working very, very closely with them. I think we made an announcement not long time ago about actually going into blockchain. One thing I want to say is that to those watching or listening, who do not understand the difference between blockchain and crypto, there's a huge difference. We're not investing in cryptocurrencies. We're not. We're investing in blockchain-based startups.
And why is that an important difference?
It's important because there is so much bad speculation in crypto. And basically, even though I believe and we believe that cryptocurrencies market is very promising, it's developed out of nowhere into a $500 billion market over basically just a couple of years. It's fantastic, but it's still extremely risky. And so while I very much support any efforts of anybody in blockchain community to make it less risky and to supplement cryptocurrencies for what we now call fiat, I still believe that where we can make a difference is applying our existing successful approach to startups, to blockchain startups, which is basically finding the companies that build solid products, that build solid business models, that know how to scale, and helping these companies with their ICOs, helping these companies with scaling, just basically doing what we do, but doing something that is really advantageous for investors because they could make their money literally sometimes in several months versus waiting for years and years for companies to succeed.
Very good. Of course, we've had this recent announcement of a partnership between Barclays and Coinbase. I'd imagine this is good news for you?
It's a fantastic news for us. We actually, I'm not an insider, so I don't know the details there, but one thing I could say that just shows a very serious move of major players into blockchain market, into crypto market, and I think there will be a lot of other major players following up. And as the big guys go there, the smaller guys like us would benefit because basically, the market would start understanding that there are great opportunities in blockchain and there are also great dangers. And I'd be happy to talk about what they are. But basically, like even, you know, if you look back in the 1990s, there were lots of very risky enterprises and a lot of people invested in dot-coms and got burnt. But there were, you know, Google, eBay, Yahoo, many, many companies that made literally billions of dollars. So that's where we are. We understand blockchain. We also understand technologies and business. And that's where we want to invest and make money.
That's brilliant, Igor. Maybe just a final word from you for investors watching this thinking, why don't I just invest in tech startups directly? Why should they come to TMT Investments?
Well, they should. My advice would be to put a little bit of money out that you want to risk and invest, and then learn very valuable lessons. But the most valuable lesson is, as to quote Warren Buffett, you should only invest in what you understand. You should not invest in what you don't understand. We're not smarter than anybody. We're not silly. The results show that we do know what we're doing, but we're definitely not smarter than anybody. What sets us apart is we have spent years and years and years learning the segments where we invest, developing connections, developing expertise, knowing people who would co-invest with us, knowing people who would like to buy those companies. And we also do, like I already said several times, a lot of legwork. Mm-hmm. We meet with thousands of companies before we make decisions, and that reflects on the quality of companies you invest in. If you only look into 5-10 companies, you know very little. If you look into literally 1,000 or 2,000 companies in the segment, you understand what makes companies successful. You understand which technologies exist out there. So my advice to anybody looking to invest directly, do invest, but just remember the 90s. The likelihood is that if you're investing in something that you don't understand very well and in which you only invest money but not a lot of time, you would not be that successful. You would be much better off if you trust the people who have been successful investing there and if you trust the people who spent a lot of time and a lot of effort understanding the segments.
Really good to meet you. Igor, thanks very much.
My pleasure.